I'm so happy to be following Caleb, and he introduced the concept of misfits, which I was in the same program. We were called the same thing. So it's good intro. My name is Ayah Bdeir. I'm the founder and CEO of littleBits. And today I'd like to talk about the present and the future of invention. I want to start to talk about some of the most famous inventors of our day. This first slide. Is it moving? Oh, sorry, I missed one. So the first slide was Elon Musk, the founder of SpaceX and Tesla and PayPal, and also started as a very curious 10-year-old who taught himself how to program because he wanted to create a game. The second innovator to focus on is Jeff Bezos. Everybody knows the founder of Amazon, a mogul who has transformed the state of the marketplace in the world, and was once a tinkerer who rigged an electric alarm to keep his siblings out of his room. Surprisingly, a very, very popular application that I'll show you a bit later. And a third example, Sheryl Sandberg, the CEO of Facebook, who is herself a really leading woman in the space of technology and founder of the Lean-In movement, who formerly was working in the World Bank, working on health projects, worked on health and blindness and a lot of economic and social impact projects, and now is leading one of the biggest problems in the world of connecting 7 billion people. The reason I talk about these famous inventors and innovators is not because they're millionaires or billionaires. It's mostly because they've all found their ways into careers in STEM and STEAM, but through very different paths. Some of them from investing in something that they did for fun, like gaming, some to solve a problem that they had for themselves, like keeping their siblings out of the room, and others, like Sheryl, combining interests that were outside the technology discipline, like social impact and economic impact. The 21st century, sorry, my slides here don't catch up. The 21st century presents a lot of new problems. Every day we see completely new problems emerge that we didn't see before. But those new problems require new skill sets. They require new careers. They require us to think differently about how we prepare the next generation. Yesterday, Dr. Kaku gave an introduction about this, talking about how to prepare for careers of the future. And so this is something that I don't have to convince this audience, but I'd like to give some insight into how we at least think about it. When I was growing up, these careers up on the screen did not exist. Careers like data science, I couldn't pick a career in data science, or space archaeology, or being a futurist. At least I didn't know that I could be a futurist. These are careers that have become available as the world has changed, and more of them are going to emerge as we go. So how do we prepare the next generation for these problems and to be prepared for these careers? We believe that we have to create the next generation inventors, critical thinkers, collaborative creators, and most importantly, lifelong learners, because we all continue to learn incessantly after we left school, and that's a skill that we have to teach the next generation. So let's talk about how we start. If this is what we're going to embark on, how do we start by preparing this next generation? STEM is, I don't have to tell this group, a national priority. Science, technology, engineering, and math is something that's become a government priority, with a lot of companies, government, and institutions spending a lot of time and money investing in to prepare the kids, the students of tomorrow, to be able to take careers in. It's also an international priority. It's happening in governments across the world. It's happening in the private sector, in the public sector. It's happening in nonprofit. And it's seen as a way to close the innovation gap and to really be at the forefront of economic development. And so the question on everybody's mind, and I hear this question over and over again, how do we engage students in STEM? How do we get them excited about STEM? How do we get them to want careers in STEM? Instead, what I believe is the even more important question is, how do we keep them engaged? I think for many of the educators in the room, you know that it's relatively easy to get a student's attention for a few minutes or a few seconds. The more challenging thing is, how do you keep their attention and how do you keep them engaged? That's something that's a lot harder, but also is where a lot more of the value comes. So I'll tell you a bit about what I do. A few years ago, I started a company called littleBits. Our mission is to democratize hardware by empowering everyone to create inventions, large and small, with a platform of easy-to-use electronic building blocks. So these little bits are electronic circuits that are building blocks They're pre-assembled, they're pre-engineered. Some are very simple, like lights and sounds and sensors, and some are very complex, like programmable or Wi-Fi connected, or motors. And they snap together with magnets so that within seconds, without any background in engineering whatsoever, you're able to start to create complex circuits that you can then turn into anything from a blinking shoe to a robot to a rigged system, which in fact some of Caleb's students connected to his, so that you can do more complex data gathering. So let's look at this video. Oh, no, before that, let me tell you why we're talking about it. So the reason I'm talking about this is to come back to the question of how do we keep students engaged. And the first principle that we've developed and really focused on at littleBits is the idea of making it fun. So if we're going to make STEM something that kids are going to get excited about, want careers in, it's not about this is what you have to do for the future. We start with let's make it fun and let's talk about something fun. And now here's a video. I believe that you start with creating these very well-curated moments of fun where then you inject educational moments. So this is an example of one of the lesson plans that we've created that go alongside littleBits, where what we tell students is they're going to invent a throwing arm. They're going to invent a contraption to throw balls onto a collection of cups and make them fall and play this game and compete against each other. But with that activity, what we're doing is we're teaching them mechanics, we're teaching them concepts of physics, we're teaching them about torque, about how to deal with motors, how to speed up motors and how not, but we're injecting this material in a fun activity that they can play and feel engaged with and feel very excited about. And so it's, fun becomes not frivolous, fun becomes a vehicle to show more complex ideas. And the result is we see our teachers really responding very well to it because they see the kids being engaged. This is one of our superstar teachers, Lisa Wang, who teaches third through fifth grade at Marymount School. She said, "My students would rather build prototypes with littleBits than go out for recess. The biggest thing is the confidence it gives them. It empowers them to challenge, shape, and change the world, and to think about ways these new technologies can help to serve others." And what they think they're doing is they're basically knocking a bunch of cups down. So it's a win-win situation. Coming back to the question, how do we keep the students engaged? Another point that's really important for us as a design principle is we want to go from STEM to STEAM. So many people in the room are already sold on this idea, but STEM covers science, technology, engineering, and math. But if you start to introduce art and humanities and design, you get the opportunity to really broaden the horizons of the students. And it's not at the expense of science, it's not the expense of technology. On the contrary, it's introducing these concepts so that they get used to ideas of not having one right answer, or ideas of iterating, or ideas of broadening their horizons and their inspiration, and that's where STEAM becomes super powerful. So in the previous example, I showed inventing a throwing arm to show concepts of physics and mechanics, but you can just as well use that when you show an example of inventing an art machine, where by the same token, you're putting a robot, having the robot draw, introducing sensors, and introducing different ideas of creating patterns, and that's your vehicle to introduce more scientific concepts. And so where it comes back, and this is our invention cycle is similar to the problem-solving method, is similar to the design thinking method. Ideas around brainstorming, divergent thinking, iteration, these things are not at odds with what we're trying to teach. On the contrary, they're empowering these kids to do even more and more powerful things. Third method, how do we keep them engaged? We believe in really helping students make it theirs. So when I went to school and we would get these project-based lessons, it was always some kind of obscure problem to somebody that lived in a remote world trying to do something that I didn't care about. The first time I learned programming, it was trying to develop a database system to sort medicine at a pharmacy. And I didn't care about the pharmacy or about databases or any of that subject. It was all very boring. I remember we glossed over those subjects all the time. So what we try to do is we really want to try to make it theirs and help them really get these personal experiences out of it. This is one of my favorite gifts, which I don't know you can't see, but instead of telling students, this will be useful for the future, you have to learn this, we try to tell them, this will help you try to create things you want now. Just like going back to Jeff Bezos, creating a sibling alarm. Creating a sibling alarm is an opportunity to learn about how to rig an alarm, how to open up this timer, how to create your own version of it, and that's a learning opportunity. So what we've developed is something called invention-based learning, which is a riff on project-based learning, which many people are already sold about. But in the case of invention-based learning, we want to tell students that it's about not seeing limits, it's about seeing possibilities. It's about really coming up with amazing, unique solutions that for problems that are important for you. Yes, these problems can be important for other people and they will inspire other people, but first and foremost, they have to be important for you because that's how you get them to go home and fall asleep thinking about that problem. You get them to go home and think about all the world around them as these tools and solutions to integrate into their solution. So it becomes a powerful vehicle for continuous learning over and over. This is an example that's really interesting. This is Max, a sixth grader, who's very concerned about his anxious cat. Apparently, over 1.5 million cats in the US are euthanized every year because they are, one of the reasons is that they're very not social around, and they're afraid around humans. And so what Max did for his science fair is he made a contraption with a motion sensor and an MP3 player. And so every time his cat would come to feed, he would listen to voices of humans and get used to the voices of humans and instead associate it with a positive thing like feeding and really start to get rid of anxiety that this cat was having. So finally, most importantly, and something that is absolutely not lost on me, is how important our educators are in the process. I said this once before, and I absolutely believe it. Educators have one of the hardest jobs in the world, getting the students engaged, keeping up with the changes in technology, changes in science, changing in notions that you have to teach, being able to have to be a mentor and a psychologist and an educator and a confidant to parents. It's a very, very difficult subject. And so what we want to do is try to empower teachers as much as we empower the students. Teachers are the hero in this process, so we want to help them be the STEAM heroes for their school. And really, you know, these are examples of mega blasters and kind of Iron Man-like contraptions that teachers can have. Maybe every teacher should have this in the class and kind of blast and get attention when you want. But the idea is that you have the power to really bring these ideas to your classrooms and shape this next generation in a way that is so unique and so important. There is an opportunity to be able to affect students at various degrees and various times in their lifetime. So a quote that really inspires me is by Mitch Resnick, the founder of Lifelong Kindergarten Group at the Media Lab. The best educational tools have low floors, high ceilings, and wide walls. So what we try to develop is these programs that go from the very low floor, lights, sound, switches, up to basic robotics, environmental sensing, music, but then all the way up to cloud connectivity, programmability, and really start to grow with the student. But also go across the spectrum, so really work across curriculum in a very wide wall perspective. So from science to humanities to art and math, really be able to jump in and out and pull different resources as you need them. So one of the things that we spent a bunch of time doing is developing this content for teachers to help them through their journey. So whether it's librarian guides or instructions for how to start STEAM programs and teacher guides, really trying to give as much as possible content to make our teachers comfortable, because if they're not comfortable, nothing good can come of it.
And in fact, what we want to try to say is, let's take this also out of the classroom. So earlier this month, we started doing a program with the New York City Department of Education to bring STEAM to after-school program. It's called the Summer of STEAM. It's across 5 boroughs, 105 teachers, 2,100 students that are going to use invention-based learning to get excited about STEAM and really do experiments that are going to get them excited and hopefully get them even more excited about the classes that they're going to do in the fall when they start. So in light of this, and I'm not just kind of preaching for the sake of preaching, we actually want to help with this. So we want to help every school get a STEAM lab in their school. So there are thousands of opportunities here with other companies and products and platforms that are being done, whether in biology, in robotics, in coding, in others. We're focused on really being able to bring these together, but we want to help our teachers. We want to help, and so we're actually offering for ISTE alone. So don't leak this onto internet, a free pro library for people that sign up on the site on this private page. But let's go back to the initial point. We want to create the next generation problem solvers, creative thinkers, people that have careers that had not been invented yet. And so I want to leave you with three short videos that show you exactly that in action.
Last year, my brother broke his arm in the summer. Bummer in the summer. For the whole summer, his arm was itchy and hot. He complained so much. Yuck!
So we invented AeroCast 3000.
This has a special cast that has a fan built into it. It also has places that you can scratch your skin if you have an itch.
Wow, I really wish my brother had this, and it's super comfortable.
Ask your doctor for an AeroCast 3000 today.
If your arm is broken.
You will be surprised.
Hi, today we want to present you our new project, Bat Vision.
It is a wearable echolocation device that can help you to detect obstacles on your way if the visibility is not good or it is total darkness around.
It also can help blind people to move around safely. Of course, it is a great toy too for playing fun games such as blindfold.
Welcome back to another episode of me, Vedanta Sai, making electronic projects. Today I've made for you guys an interactive, now listen to this sentence, pin golf. Pin golf, not pinball, okay? I'd like to keep that in mind with you. What that is an interactive golf club and it has to do with this pinball arcade. So let me just give you a quick demo. Like I do in all my videos. Let me just put the pinball ball right there. Now, whenever the golf club interacts with the ball, this mechanical arm right there will hit that ball. Watch. Let me just try to get in one of the holes. Oh, it came back out.
Imagine in this case, Vidan wants to be a virtual athletic engineer. Imagine the picture that we saw a little earlier of the Martian thinking about being an intergalactic farmer, or you know, creating careers in the future of being an artificially intelligent robot psychologist. These careers are going to happen. These careers are coming our way. And so there is no way to prepare our students for them. There is no way to anticipate what they're going to be. What we can do is prepare them to be problem solvers, creative thinkers, and to be lifelong learners. And that's something that we are so inspired and also laughing out loud about. So there's no better way to do it. So we're here. We have our booth, booth 1332. Come over, play with some stuff, look at what we're up to. We're super excited to learn from you, the good and the bad. Please come visit us. And don't forget to sign up for the competition. Thank you very much.